A new name, a new truck, and a brand new target. That's this week on Motoring 2001.
TSN's Motoring 2001 is brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oils, formulated for the vehicles you drive and the way you drive them. And Midas. Keep a good thing going. Go Midas.
This week we're going to begin with a little word association, and that word is Toyota. And of course, the first word that comes to mind is quality, which is one of the reasons the Camry continues to be the number one selling car in North America. And how about Lexus? It could be argued that Lexus set the benchmark for luxury in North America. In fact, it could be said that Toyota has scored a bullseye every time they have ventured into a new market. Yet Toyota dealers look at the competition and see them making bundles of cash on large and small sport utes and full-size pickup trucks. The answer? Get into the subcompact market with the RAV4, and then introduce a full-size pickup with the Tundra. Well, it hasn't been since 1989 with the Land Cruiser since Toyota has had a full-size sport ute. Well, that's about to change, as Toyota is about to take on the Ford Expedition head-on with the brand-new out-of-the-box Sequoia. And this company is convinced it is about to score another bullseye.
We've had that good heritage of Toyota, the small truck. We've had a strong image with 4Runner. But we've come out now with the new RAV4, a very new, exciting vehicle. We have at the top end the all-new Sequoia, which moves into a totally new segment for us. And we're the first serious, I guess, non-North American, shall I say, although we do consider ourselves North American, player in that market segment. So that's a big move for us using the Tundra platform.
I think it was sort of inevitable for them. They're obviously, as are most manufacturers, putting a lot more emphasis on trucks because that's what the market's demanding these days, which is all kind of silly, but there it is. And there's a lot of profitability in them, I think. So why wouldn't they? They have the platform, or had the platform already in the Tundra. So I think putting a full-size sports utility body on that wasn't a huge or hugely expensive leap.
We're right in that segment. If you look at the features of the vehicle, the engine, it's a V8 engine, which I think is a basic to get in there. It's an 8-passenger vehicle. You can get limited with all the toys and goodies on there that kind of customer is going to expect.
It's a full-time four-wheel drive vehicle. It also can run in two-wheel drive. It's got what's called the multi-mode system, allows it to drive in two-wheel drive, four-wheel drive, four-low, etc.
Also, we have standard vehicle skid control. It's an electronically controlled stability system. And also, we have standard A-track, which is active traction control, which is good both on on-road situations, such as snow and ice, and also for off-road, where we have like limits of suspension travel. So if some wheel is slipping, instead of losing that torque, we can transfer the torque to the other side so we can maintain good vehicle performance. Power plant, we're using the same engine that's used in the Tundra full-size pickup. It's a V8 dual overhead cam, 32 valves, 4.7 liter with sequential multi-port fuel injection. The engine is a 4-speed electronically controlled transmission. Again, this is has been used successfully in the Tundra. So overall, it's a very quiet power plant. In the Sequoia's application, it develops 240 horsepower and 315 foot-pounds of torque.
Gas prices are going up, and the trucks are getting bigger. Have you figured this one out?
Well, as we showed you yesterday, this one meets ultra-low emission standards within Canada and the United States. It's friendly, definitely when it comes to fuel consumption, and prices are rising, but at the same time, I think people are looking for ways to make sure they're not being inefficient with their gas usage, and this kind of vehicle will help them with that.
I don't think they're going to hurt Ford particularly in this market, because they do own that market in the U.S. especially. But they will make a significant dent, and it gives also an opportunity for those who love the import brands for specific reasons. It gives them an opportunity to buy an import and have the size of vehicle that they need for the job that they need.
You live in Japan.
Yes, of course.
What do Japanese people think of North Americans' love affair with big, big trucks like this?
Frankly speaking, when starting our program, we did not have enough knowledge about the full-size SUV. And so in order to achieve our program, we had a main chance to hear the opinion from North American and Canadian market.
You won't see these on the streets in Japan, though, probably.
For cities in Japan, I think Sequoia is a little big, yes. I don't want the Sequoia driven in the city of Japan. It's only for Canadian Americans.
It's a move-up vehicle. We have very strong history with 4Runner and even RAV in the past. Those people are, you know, as they move through the different evolutions of their life, they're going to be looking for something else. And Sequoia is this vehicle. That's the one for them. I guess the benchmark before has been Ford Expedition. They've been the big players in that market, and we're there to take a little bit of that business away, quite frankly, and the vehicle's been designed to meet them right head on.
But what's all of that without the tunes? Well, they actually thought about that, because there's controls right here. You crank it up, and life really is good. Way to...
Imagine Olympic 100-meter dash champion Maurice Greene is running beside that traffic. Who's going to get here first? Well, I'll let you know later on Kenzie's Corner.
Over the years, Pontiac has earned a reputation, and rightly so, for their loud, proud, in-your-face styling. Well, this week on Test Drive, we take a look at their loudest venture to date. This is the all-new 2001 Aztek, a vehicle that can only be described as very much being in-your-face.
Power for the Aztek comes from a free-revving 3.4-litre overhead valve V6 that's good for 185 horsepower and a generous 210 pounds-feet of torque at 4,000 rpm. And while it follows GM's pushrod theory, it is smooth, responsive, and according to Bill Gardner, easier to work on. The only box available is a 4-speed automatic that's up to GM's norm, meaning slick. Now this powertrain combination works well together, giving a strong push off the line and plenty of passing power in the mid-range. Even during the enthusiastic moments, the engine remains fairly quiet and the shift between gears all but undetectable.
You know, when it comes to out-and-out versatility, very few vehicles are the equal of the Aztek. This netting system, for instance, well, it can be configured no fewer than 22 different ways, and these large nets will hold 100 pounds apiece. Tumble the rear seats forward and you can actually accommodate a 4x8 sheet, albeit with a tailgate down. There's an optional air mattress. And what's an air mattress without a tent? Well, you can also get one of those that attaches to the back of the vehicle. But the part that I really do like, the tailgate itself has been configured so that it's comfortable to sit on, and there's a spot for your favorite beverage. The only thing that's missing is tunes. Well, Pontiac actually thought about that and put some controls right here. Life is indeed sweet.
Aztek's ride quality is surprisingly compliant. The McPherson strut design up front features 4-stage shocks, while the rear gets a twist beam that benefits from load-leveling shocks when you take the optional towing package. Through the pylons, the Aztek remained remarkably unflustered. Sure, there's a lot of body roll, and the tires complain a lot as you load them up, but for a tall vehicle, it handles very well. The wide track and a progressive rack and pinion steering round out a decent dynamic package.
You know, when you return the rear seats to the upright position, you're in for another pleasant surprise, primarily because the seat itself is actually long enough to give you thigh support. There's plenty of room under the front seat for your toes, loads of knee room, plenty of headroom. In short, it's a very comfortable environment. And yes, there's yet another set of radio controls back here.
Stopping power comes from a front disc rear drum design that uses four-channel anti-lock brakes. The stops are short, the design fade free, and the pedal easily modulated thanks to its firm feel. The ABS also works in reverse to deliver a decent traction control system.
Up front, the Aztek, well, it's a story of mixed blessings. While you get all the comfort and convenience items you can shake a stick at, and the controls themselves are actually logically placed, there's a large discrepancy with the consistency with which they operate. The other thing, the plastic that surrounds everything is tacky personified. On a more positive note, the center console doubles as a cooler. What a great idea. The other thing, you get these handy little tote bags that fit right into the door pocket. And if you happen to get lost, not a problem. Simply punch the OnStar button and talk to a very polite person through the hands-free microphone and they'll tell you where to go.
On the safety front, Aztek brings front and side airbags, and there's the option of an all-wheel drive version that automatically relays power to the rear wheels should the fronts begin to slip. Now the system is also sophisticated enough to direct the power to the left or right rear wheel, whichever has the best grip.
You know, from a purely clinical perspective, the new Aztek has got everything you could possibly want. It's comfortable, its dynamic demeanor is all it should be, and it's powerful. When it comes to versatility, frankly, there's nothing on the market can match it. But as a buddy of mine, Kevin, says, this thing is neither station wagon nor SUV. Rather, it's the first generation UV. Now, who am I to argue with a sentiment like that? Oh yeah, UV, he reckons it stands for ugly vehicle.
Our Midas Tip of the Week concerns checking the freeze protection of your coolant. It's an important annual step in maintaining your car to check the freeze protection of that coolant. You don't know that somebody may have watered down that coolant during the summer to the point where it doesn't have adequate freeze protection. It also affords you a chance to look at the quality of the coolant and see if it's cloudy or rusty looking and in need of flushing. Sometimes there's enough corrosion in the cooling system that you can't even see this red pointer to indicate the freeze protection. That's an obvious indication that the cooling system needs flushing. Once you've checked the freeze protection, take a crayon and write down the freeze protection level on the upper rad hose and the date that you checked it. It'll also give you a good reminder of when you need to flush the coolant next. Depending on the type of coolant, it may be 2-year intervals or as long as 5 years if you're using Dex Cool coolant. That's your Midas Tip of the Week.
It's a 1971 Chevelle SS with a 454 engine. I got it because I used to love motorcycles, but I realized it's better to be protected by a body around you. So I switched to muscle cars, and I fell in love with my Chevelle as soon as I saw her, and I've had her for now 6 years. It's a great feeling to have so much power and be able to use it or not use it depending on the situation on the road. And it's great to just enjoy it when the weather is nice and go on the road and drive forever. It's just wonderful. People don't believe it's my car. I always have to prove it. I have to show my papers. They say, is it your boyfriend or your husband? I said, no, it's mine. It's not your typical French woman's car. You know, people expect a French woman to drive like a Renault 5 or something like that, not a Chevelle SS with a 454 engine. So that's the reaction I get. And people are surprised and always ask me, like, what is it like? They want to drive it. Everybody wants to drive it, but nobody does.
You know, when I leave my car in the garage, when I park it at night, I just turn around and have a big smile for my car, or when I come down in the morning to drive or something, my car makes me smile. Every time I see my car in the street, in the garage, anywhere, I got a big smile on my face. It's my pride. I just love my car.
When I drive my Chevelle, I feel like it's a sense of history because it's an older car, it's 30 years old, and there's not many of those on the road in such a good shape. So it's part of history of America, of North America, and that's one part I really enjoy. It's not your everyday car. It's not a car I could use every day to go to work and things like that, because it's, first of all, it's a gas guzzler, and you cannot park that everywhere also, because, you know, you don't want dents in it or anything. When I get behind my wheel, it's like not more than a toy, it's a passion.
So if there's any other woman who loves car watching right now, I strongly recommend you get a nice car, something you really love, something that's you. This might not be you, but something you will love, and that will be there for you when you need it. It's there, it's reliable, it's enjoyable, and doesn't let you down.
You know, one of the most desirable features in today's cars and trucks are the number of cup holders they have. Well, the Sequoia is up there with the best, with no fewer than 10 cup holders. They have 5 power outlets, but I think this truck has set a whole new benchmark when it comes to places to put your sunglasses. Most vehicles, if you're lucky, have 1 sunglass holder, not the Sequoia. Not 2, not 3, not 4. This truck has 5 sunglass holders. I kid you not. Well, as far as I'm concerned, it's overkill. They could have put the space to much better use. But I guess if the whole family's going to drive in a Sequoia, it's important to look cool. All right, let's head to the garage and join Bill Gardner.
Brad, it's only important to be cool when you're the host of the show. When you're the mechanic, it's usually to cover a black eye or bloodshot eyes. Anyhow, I'm a real big believer in storage space in a vehicle, so that sunglass storage, I guess, would come in handy. But if you've got a vehicle that doesn't have that capability, here's a way that we're going to show you this week that you can gain some storage space and maybe add a safety feature to your vehicle. Now, quite often I find that when I'm driving customers' vehicles, I turn a corner while I'm road testing the vehicle and the sun is low on the horizon. I need to pull the visor down. I pull it down and I get an avalanche of receipts and notepads, tire pressure gauges, etc. I guess these people wear their sunglasses all the time and they're giving up the use of that visor. But when you've got multiple people driving the vehicle, it can be a bit of a safety issue. So here's a product that we've picked up at Canadian Tire, half a dozen examples of visor organizers. For example, this one's got a nice pouch here where you can slide those sunglasses that we talked about right in there to keep them at hand. There's a slot there for your pen and tire pressure gauge. This one is set up for CDs, so you can see all the slots in here where your CDs can slide in. And if you flip them over, you can see the Velcro tethers that allow them to be adjusted to any type of sun visor. Here's a slightly different one with some zipped pouches and slots over here for your pen, tire pressure gauge, etc. There's the Velcros again. This is a more deluxe version that's got an opening for a garage door opener here, a mesh opening, and some more zipped pouches. There's your slot for your sunglasses. And here's one made of a slightly higher quality material that also accepts CDs as well. And these things are really a good area to also store your maintenance records and gas receipts, etc. Whenever we're servicing a car, we always put our maintenance records up here so that the customer or the client can pull down the visor and refer to the odometer reading on the car and see how long it's been since they had an oil change, since they had the cooling system flushed, a brake job or whatever. So set aside at least one slot in your visor organizer to keep those maintenance records. It's a lot better than having those magnetic cling stickers on the windshield or a sticker on the end of your door that you're just not going to see. They get washed out, they fall off, etc. If it's up here, it's easy to refer to. When you're stuck in traffic, you can find out if that vehicle's overdue for service. Till next week, I'm Bill Gardner for Motoring 2001.
Do you know how fast you can run? Well, the Olympic gold medalist in the 100-meter dash averages about 36 kilometers an hour. The average person in good condition probably tops out around 20, 25. That's not very fast. And a walking pace, well, that's only 7 kilometers an hour. And you know, our bodies are genetically programmed to handle speeds like that. That's why when you walk into a door, it hurts so much. That's only 7K. And yet we're driving around every day at 5, 10 times that kind of speeds. That's why we got to wear seatbelts in cars, because if we hit something at that speed, our bodies aren't evolutionarily designed to handle that kind of impact. And there's another aspect of it we have to consider when driving, and that is the speed at which things are coming towards us. I mean, evolution has taught us that our enemies are typically approaching at 10 or 15 kilometers an hour, not 120. And it takes a long time for drivers to develop the kind of experience to appreciate the closing speeds of other vehicles. Now, this message is aimed primarily at you younger viewers, because we know you're out there. Yes, I know your reflexes are terrific, and you're young, and you're strong, and you're invincible, but it takes 3 or 4 years behind the wheel before you really get an appreciation of how fast vehicles are approaching you. We had a terrible crash near our house not too long ago. 3 young teenagers killed when their car was hit by a train. We don't know exactly what happened, but I'll bet part of the problem was those young people, the driver of that car anyway, just didn't know how long it was going to take him to get to that level crossing or how long it was going to take the train to get there. So please, young people, if you're in a situation where you have to guess, is it going to be 3 seconds or 4 seconds, take the conservative, cautious approach. Let the car go, wait until you know you've got lots of time to make that particular move. It's not like the 100 meter dash where it's over in 9.9 seconds. And if you're gone, you're going to be gone for a lot longer than that. I'm Jim Kenzie.
Every now and then in our travels, we come across what could be described as different or unusual sights. Well, such is the case here in the mountains of British Columbia. This is known as a logging trail, and as you can see, it's very narrow. Well, logging trucks are very wide, and the locals continually warn you to be alert, or it could result in tragic consequences. Well, alongside this road, we have discovered an automobile graveyard. And what's interesting about it is there seems to be cars of every vintage, even dating back to the early 40s. Now, is this just a reminder of what could happen up here if you don't stay alert? Nobody seems to know. It's enough to give you the willies. But enough of the past. Let's talk about the future concerning Toyota. You know, we're used to GMC, Ford, and Dodge truck, and now we got a new kid on the block with Toyota truck. And this week out here in British Columbia, we've had a chance to look at a couple of their newest vehicles. First, the new and improved RAV4. And with more horsepower, more interior space, and what I think is a hot new design, maybe the people at Honda might be thinking of a new and improved CR-V. And as for the Sequoia, well, Toyota has made no bones about it. They're going right after the Ford Expedition. So with that in mind, we're going to join Graham Fletcher in a future program on the test track, and we'll pit the Sequoia and the Expedition head-to-head. Well, that and more as we continue to bring you more stories about cars and the people who drive them.
We know that 15 to 20% of Acura customers right now are leaving the family because we don't offer an upscale sports utility vehicle. And we believe that with the MDX now, we can stop those people leaving the family.
TSN's Motoring 2001 has been brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oils, formulated for the vehicles you drive and the way you drive them. And Midas, keep a good thing going. Go Midas.